is, and there's more red on that on those papers, red ink than black ink. Hopefully by the end of the course, it'll be a lot better. Yeah, it's pretty grim.
Well.
But you're hurting my feelings. I need a good grade. Is there a safe place somewhere?
No. But unfortunately, I am afraid we're changing our curriculum in the fall. And good news is they're going to have a comprehensive exam at the end to increase academic rigor. Bad news is the curriculum is getting dumbed down so much they hardly have any tests until the last comprehensive exam. So there's no real workup. So I fear for the dilemma. Is going to be put in when, because I suspect we'll probably have anywhere between 30 to 50% of the students fail to come. And what will we do then? We'll see.
There's nothing wrong with failing, you know? Sometimes you just gotta learn. Yes.
Jim Lacey out at Marineford University wrote this big thing about working in a classroom, and Naval War College just took him out to the woodshed.
Oh, seriously? Well, how exciting.
That's great, because Jim's using games, I recognize. He's using Triumph and Tragedy, he's using Paulus, he's using, Paths of Glory, some of the people, a lot of these other games that you recognize.
Right, yeah, I see, that was a great article that he wrote.
Yeah.
Or whoever wrote it about him, I think someone wrote it about, oh no, he wrote it himself, didn't he?
He wrote it.
Yeah. Perfect. Nothing like grown men behaving like children. Well, how's our gracious host? He's here.
Yeah, but he's on mute. You see the little mute? There's one.
Yeah, I'm not catching 100% of this. I guess I don't have a good conditions here. What have you guys gone over already? Sounds like you guys have already...
Nothing, really. We were just listening to Eric complain.
Game. So who
it's not very
remember?
means I was playing catch up the whole game. Well, you know, 12 turns. It's pretty steep effect there. But I got to Venus Heights, you know, clearing. And we had to stop with just a few turns left. I don't think the British would have made it. But it was fun anyways.
Fun game, fun series. You know.
Yeah.
I don't think Saratoga's the best in the world. But it was a good RPG.
Yeah.
So it got me interested.
Oh yeah. That was the other thing I noticed playing it, the potential for bigger battles. So I have Germantown and Monmouth already, so that's available. I also have set up over here Devil's Horseman, and I finally am going through some of that. Surprise, surprise, I love it.
That's awesome. It's funny you've got, I didn't know you had that set up. I just pulled it out myself.
Devil's Horseman?
The GBOH game? Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, cool. I didn't realize that. hey, I got this in the mail. I'm gonna do some bench presses with this.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, all right.
This sucker is huge. And Eric, I got several questions for you on this.
Rocka.
There's just one and a half.
Yeah, you're lagging a little bit, but not badly.
Are there two different map sets?
Yeah.
This one and a half.
Hopefully you got the good map set. There are three. Three different, well, let me take that back. There are three map sets for Gross Deutschland. That's, there is the first set, the deluxe set, which I hesitate to call deluxe. And then the redrawn set.
And I take it you're a fan, Eric?
Yes, but with caveats. I don't think it's a game for everyone. I really don't. Very expensive. Extremely expensive. I like the scale. I like the scope. But you really have to like tactical games. And the other problem with it is, you know, the Germans just kick ass. And it's really hard playing the Russians. In terms of, you know, keeping your personal morale check up. Because you're always, so it's one of those games where, as a Russian, you've got to be one of those people that love setting traps and are willing to take a lot of losses and so forth in the game, like most Russian fun games. So it's kind of that way. And then the system, you just got to like the system. But I've only played the scenarios. I've never played, and I haven't played anywhere near never played a campaign game, which I think probably is where this game shines. But especially with the enhancements, when you're doing tank recovery and supply and command control and fire support and all that, I think that game probably really, really shines. But I'm telling you, Grognard Simulations is aptly named. You really have to be
sure I don't miss one of the East Front base games for the Death Ride series. So I think I have a ton of gaming to get out of this. So I plan to enjoy it.
You will. Oh my God, you will. Yeah, he's redoing the book.
And I also...
He's redoing the three...
What's that?
Gross Deutschland. He's redoing the three Gross Deutschland games. And I'm thinking, you know...
Oh, wow.
I poured maybe $400 into those. Now he's redoing them. It's like, killing me, man.
What's
the nature of the
yeah.
Review?
What's in the update?
He redid the maps. Now, for those of us who bought the entire SS... He gave us those maps for free. But I had to buy the second edition counters. Alright? You know, when Gross Deutschland came out for all those games. Alright? So that was a decent expense. So I expect second edition will have the new maps, new counters, and I expect the rule book will be brought up to Totem Cup standards. So my feeling is I probably don't need. I think I'm not going to get any more. There's supposed to be one more set, trilogy set on Southern Bulge first that he wants to do. And I'm like, I just can't imagine. No. But they were able to be able to do the entire first Southern Offensive at the platoon and company level. You can imagine that.
It's crazy. Hey, when you say redo the county, you're not saying the counters have ever changed in substance, have you? These are just facelifts, right?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. Graphic facelifts.
Are the counters backless? Do they have any art on the back?
If I remember correctly, yes, they do. But
they're double sided.
Yeah, they're double sided. The change was mostly in terms of putting tank silhouettes on the armor units and just making them clearer.
Okay.
I can see that.
Okay. So it's very different from the Island War series that he did.
Oh, very, very different. And it's interesting, the Island War series was kind of a, prequel, for lack of a better term, for his Armored Knights games. So they're not even Death Ride type. More related to the Armored Knights. Although, of course, they're mostly infantry primarily.
Yeah. Yeah, I was underwhelmed by that game and the system.
Yeah. Because those are the first games he did.
Right. Oh, really? Okay.
Hey, Kev.
Rolling.
Yeah, hey, Kev, I know I watched your videos on Guam, right?
Yeah.
And I know you weren't happy with them. Can you, like, I don't have any of those series. I have the Iwo Jima, but I don't know if I'll ever even bother playing it. I was wondering if you could elaborate on your disappointment. There was something about the combat system as well, right?
Yeah, so for me, I think there were three things. The first, and I'll try and see if I can get this right. The first thing was the map art and the counter art and the counter format was horrible. So the backs of them are just bare cardboard. So 400 or 500 counters, if you don't keep track of them and keep them organized, you're constantly flipping them over to see what's what. The map art was just horrible. It's a bunch of 11 by whatever 17 maps or whatever the size of an A4 piece of paper is, right? 11 by 12. And I would say the game could have been played on had more space dedicated to the land and made the hexes bigger and more detailed and have less ocean around it, because you don't need the ocean. You've got these cruisers and ships offshore that provide bombardment. Well, you don't even actually need them there because they're never going to die and they can't be hit. There's no aircraft to sink them. There's no subs to sink them. So it's just a waste of counters and a waste of space. So you miss an opportunity to have a much easier user interface. So that's the first thing. Second thing was the rules and the victory conditions I thought were just very, very mediocre. I couldn't actually work out how you win the game in that particular game. There was some, you know, capture all the objectives. Okay, well, what are the objectives? They're not declared anywhere in the rules. It's 11 or 12 pages of rules that were just kind of written. So that's the second thing. The third thing was the combat system really penalized you in certain ways for having powerful attacks. So you're better off attacking at lower odds with less DRMs and tightening the band of possible results you could get. And because you're penalized if you lose too many units in the game, that takes away victory points. So you can't afford to lose more than were lost historically. But if you get an overwhelming attack, you lose more units. So you lose more steps in the combat. So if you roll really well and you roll an 11, or say it's a D10, I think, and you roll a D10 and you roll and get 3 or 4 DRMs on it, maybe it's a D8, I forget. And then you get 3 or 4 DRMs. Well, you kill 5 steps, but you lose 2. Well, the Japanese they're staying until they die, so they don't care. They happily be killed all day long. But the Yanks have got to only lose 1 or 2 at a time. And as you start going through the combats, you can see that, well, you're not going to make it. I was halfway through the first day, and I was like, well, this is stupid because I'm not going to meet the victory conditions. So that was my beef, I would say, those three things.
The game reminded me of old FBI games in that it's a puzzle game.
Right.
So it's, you know, the Japanese players really not much to do. So it could be a base for solitaire treatment. And two, for the American player, it's all about how do I manage expected losses?
Right. Right, you've got to be careful. You've got to optimize all these attacks, otherwise you lose too many units. So to me, it just felt like, well, I'm bringing all the right pieces to the battle and getting all the right DRMs, but I'm losing more than I should. So really, I should attack at 3-1 instead of 5-1.
It's about managing probabilities. You're looking for that sweet spot.
Right.
Managing, shaping your probabilities so that over time.
Yeah, and if I wanted to do that, I'd just, you know, I'd read a book, right?
Right.
So, that was tedious.
Hey, Kev, I remember from your video talking about how the actual layout of the combat results seemed screwy.
Yeah.
So I think that's what you just said there. However, and Eric, if you know, has Fasulo ever explained this layout of the combat results? Because, I mean, this might just be garbage, okay? But obviously, designers have tried to bake in different ideas into the CRT that are not necessarily obvious.
Yeah, that's true. But I think I have one quick comment on that, and that would be, it makes sense that at a 5-1 attack, I would lose more because I've got more guys in the fight and there's just a greater chance that guys are going to die. I got that, but the fact that you had better chances at 4-1 of doing an almost equivalent amount of damage than at 5-1, you know, it annoyed me. Now Eric may have some actual facts to back that up, because I was just
really want 2 and 3-1 because 4-1
Right. Well, all I know is I have iron balls.
Hey, the other thing about kind of what you said about that game is, has anybody done a comparison of like the Island Wars series there and Legion games? I have it over here, but I can't dig it out.
Yep. Yep. I've read the rules for it, and I compared the rule books side by side, and they're very similar in play sequence and rule effect. In fact, almost, I wouldn't say they're identical, but they're near enough to the same that they're the same. I don't know that they play the same, and I certainly do know that the components are better just because it's a Legion game, so without even seeing it. But it's on my list to play. I've got a vassal module for, I think it's Saipan, and I've got the rules, so, but I just haven't got to it. Have you played, Eric or Devin? Have you played
Island War?
Okay, so there you go. I didn't like Attu at all. I have not played it, but I sat with two guys while they played and they went through the whole thing. It's a very different system from the Island Wars, Legion Games Island Wars, whoever does that design. I'm sadly I can't remember the guy's name, but it's a different system, and it was not that interesting. They both played it and went, yeah, I guess we could play it again, but not that much to do for the Japanese. Right.
Because you're just trying to figure out how can I do the Japanese setup, and once you set it up, you really don't have much more to do.
Right.
It's a hard subject to do at that stage. So I think you're better off playing those specific battles at the tactical scale, like ASL or something like that.
Heroes of the Pacific. Ooh, that's so pretty. It's so not.
I think at that scale, those things are interesting. The operational scale. And I also played this week Kirkholm 1605 from Vindictus. Hey, Eric, do you know the history? Do you know the history of Ben Hall designed Paris, Beauvien, and the Mesa, or whatever? Was that his very first published game?
Now that I didn't know if that's true. The only thing I knew about Ben was his first game being the Cursed Civil War, the Civil War for GMT. If he did something earlier than that.
Okay, I think he did I think he did something for Vivictus magazine there. And then picked up the idea. And it was Ben Hall's blessing. Coupeau took the ideas that became Musket and Pike, and Coupeau kind of did a parallel lineage of a streamlined Musket and Pike. And it really is basically a streamlined Musket and Pike. Like, instead of four orders, there's three. Instead of Musket and Pike has like five or even six different types of fire. In the AIR series, as I call it, that's Avec Infinie Regret.
Right, right.
There's just offensive and defensive fire, but it's the same concept of, you know, reaction fire. You can fire if a unit changes hex within your fire zone. A lot of the same spirit of musket and pike, just strict, probably half the playing time. And incredibly engaging, especially considering these are, like, Pure Foam is a magazine game, so I can't say enough good things about it. Although, of course, it just whets my appetite for Mustard and Pike.
Right.
which is okay.
Which is a great series.
That's worth the money.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
I had known that. Hey, you put out on Board Game Geek that we were talking about the most or the highly complex games.
Let me explain that. So the other day I was preparing the chess for Gres, the strategy and tactics game from only from like 4 years ago. I think it's Pirello design. And as I was prepping the chips, I was like, wow, this is kind of this is simple game. And then I thought, this game seems to be largely forgotten, not well regarded, by the way.
And which
game? Then I was thinking,
close up. Which game was this?
Oh, let me show you.
He's so enthusiastic.
Four games on that list. But it's interesting you talk about Southern Storm, especially with the expansion, Devils to Pay, which really opens up that game a great deal. It's funny because I never considered that game all that complicated. Yet it was, I thought, a great compromise in terms of color and chrome and complexity. I thought it was eminently more playable than Terrible Sword, and honestly more realistic. So 3 days of Gettysburg and, you know, Regimental Subseries, this Hollow Ground, and some of these other games, they're a little more complicated, but not that much more so. And I think they're honestly a little better. But Summer Storm had that brief moment, I thought, where, yeah, that's the monster Gettysburg game.
Hey, Eric, would you be surprised that Summer Storm has a 4.21 weight rating?
No, I'm not surprised.
Okay.
I mean, part of the problem is that if you're gonna play a game of that scale, it really abstracts a lot of the tactical resolution. And if you've been growing up on Great Battles of the American Civil War, some of those stuff, you're like, I don't want this generalized. The game really focused more on command and a lot less on the tactical execution. It was the Fallen Eagles. Waterloo 1815 of its day. That makes sense. People didn't want that. No, my God, I want to run my division in exquisite tactical detail. You're generalizing things. I don't want that.
Hey, Eric, what do you think of Shetler's Edelweiss? That's over 4.5. Way
rating. And I hate it. I played all of those games. Every last one, to include Edelweiss, okay? I played everything he did on the Eastern Front. Here's the issue. The designs are honestly a little too baroque. There's a little too much complexity and needless complications. That said, especially Edelweiss, here's what I loved about it. When you laid that map out, you saw these vast spaces, and there aren't any counties. And so if you really wanted that feeling of tiny German columns going into this Das Fox alarm, right? You definitely got that. Of course, John Shetler's system was very big on logistics. It was the OCS of its day. So this is a reason why Mark Stumpfer absolutely raves about it. He likes it even better than OCX. I would say, okay, I can kind of see why you'd say that, but some of these routines are just a little too much. The best thing about Edelweiss and a lot of the later games in the Winter Storm series was the optional command and control rules, because both the Soviet and German player have to get permission from their high commands to do things. The high commands will give them objectives. And a lot of times you're going to go, I don't want to do that. Whether you're the Soviet or the German, you're like, I don't want to do that. So what the game mechanic does is give you the opportunity to appeal to Stalin and Hitler. And part of doing that is you have to get weight of opinion from your subordinate generals who are actually counters on the board. And they're commanding these various corps and army headquarters. And you're trying to get as many of them on your side. Now, it's a loss versus a gain problem, because the more you get on your side, the greater the chance that the high command will go with you. But it's not guaranteed. And if you lose, Stalin and Hitler will cashier, remove, or censure your subordinate generals. And that has huge effects on what's going on in the battlefield at that particular time. I thought that was brilliant. I want that system in all my OCS games on the Eastern Front because it's that good. And that, to me, was the best thing about those systems.
So is that an expansion for Edelweiss, or is that an errata set, or what is that?
In the game, but you'll find that game in Edelweiss. You'll find it in the original Winter Storm game. It wasn't there yet.
Hell, you could almost make a game on that alone.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, Devin, that was the whole thing. It was a game within the game. And when you played it, you felt like my real enemy is my heart. As Marine Commandant Alfred Gray said, man's only natural enemy is his heart.
And one more this week. I played and made a few videos on. I dug out one of Wargaming's most infamous criminals and actually enjoyed playing it. This is Austerlitz, 1805, Avalanche Press. Rob Markham, supposedly. I actually enjoyed it. And in the video I explained, well, I hope I explained why. Eric, comments.
Well, let me ask you, I've not played it. So is that in the Eagles and Empire series that they started with? They did an ILO game, they did, okay. If that's true, Marcus Stumpter will tell you that is the best tactical polyonic system ever made. Okay. And I have only played later games than that, and I wish I had the earlier ones because he raves about them so much, and I trust his judgment on that because he is so into Napoleonic warfare. So hang on to that game because it's a good one. The other one that Avalanche did was ILOW, which everyone that I know of says that's the best depiction of battle. So it's like, I don't have those. And I remember when they were advertised, I was like, they don't look like they're serious. I can't go with those. So I passed them by, and now I'm afraid.
Eric, I'm sorry you came in half garbled, but I think I got a lot of that. You're talking about Stumpter, right?
Right.
Yeah, I actually am going. I'm actually going back and reading from the beginning on Constant World Forums, and he was very heavily in early on, and you can tell how excited he was about the whole system. Now in the video, I explain, I think, anyways, it's not that important, but for me to you, this game has the charge, the accusation, that no terrain leading into the air, and that's what it's all about. So terrain analysis went into the ILOW game, and terrain analysis went into the newer Spanish games, for example, but people accuse Avalanche Press at this point in the evolution of the family of games of having not done the terrain analysis to actually build the areas. And in my video, I know I say, look, I realize that these map areas may not have come from real terrain analysis, and frankly, that's a shame. However, as a game, I liked about what I was totally shocked about was I was totally drawn into how to put together large formation, infantry, cavalry, artillery, combined arms attacks, given the very unique terrain that all those irregular areas create.
Right.
And that was a lot of fun. Now, is that really the Austerlitz battlefield? I can't say, but let's just say that it is a game version of Austerlitz battlefield. Then it was a lot of fun. I explained the video. The reason for doing that video was specifically to pull out a dog and play it itself and figure out what's really going on. People say in one of the maps, I don't like the map, but I found myself getting past the map. and then it just kind of goes from there, but it's actually quite fun. I mean, I say go from there, people say it has horrible play aids, people even say the counters are hard to read, and I explain in the video what I find and don't find, but the game was surprisingly intriguing, so just interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know that I found an Austerlitz game that I really like. Not that I've played them. So I never played the old Lavakai series on that game, which I'm told is a real beast. I played the old SPI game. I played the Napoleon Brigade series by the gamers. I played Napoleon's Triumph and so forth. They're all okay for various things, but the one I haven't played is an old EMT game that Rich Berg, I think,
Didn't Berg do one?
Austerlitz. I haven't played that.
Didn't Berg do an Austerlitz title?
Yeah, I think he did. And it was one of those mini monster type games. But I haven't played that one, so this makes me think I'm still looking for the ultimate Austerlitz game. It's a grail.
That guy.
That's the one.
Yeah, I'm.
Haven't done that one.
I'm looking forward to trying this one, actually.
What scale?
On this particular one, it is. Stand by. Gonna say it's 100-meter hexes by the looks of it.
It's regimental.
Yeah.
Regimental. Big.
Yeah, 150-yard hexes, and we're dealing with the strength point is 100 men, and the average counter's got 500 men. Yeah, so it's regimental scale, probably.
Is that a one-off game? That's not a serious game, is it?
I don't know.
No, the only one done. Only one done. They did a game called Borodino.
Right.
Not as detailed and big.
So you can see there's one division there that's got all the color bands tie the different divisions together. So, anyway, on the list at some point.
Okay,
what have you guys been in?
I think you can safely put that off for a while.
I can put it off for a while?
Hey, so what have you guys been playing or acquiring or looking at?
So, Devin, what have you been looking at? Century on the table and getting some videos done of that. I want to do
this must be. This must be full blow. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. That's a feature. I'm glad you started a blog. I've only read 50 pages of it, just all the introductory stuff. I'm reading Natsuya's article, not Asura's article. Is that what his name is?
Yeah, Peter Soros.
Oh, no, the Japanese guy. Sorry, Natsura?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I'm reading his right now. It's a little... The foreword was a little pompous, I felt, but... Yeah, it seemed like it.
You know the game. If you played the game, you're like, yeah, got it. But if you haven't, and you don't know anything about it, you breathe. Doesn't really hit.
Right. Yeah. Well, it's something we could stick on our bookshelf and pretend that we're intellectual.
Beautiful. That cover is beautiful. I look at that cover and I think of Advanced Millennium Wars Counterfact magazine, Lebanon 2006 and so forth.
Yeah, I'm keen to play that game. That looks like a really interesting game.
Yes. Yeah. Well, that's all I've been doing.
You guys got me?
Yep.
I can't hear you.
Yes.
Damn.
Can you hear me?
We can hear you. We
never mind.
So, Kev, what have you been doing? I've kind of been watching what you've been doing on your blog. I love you playing Loose Nukes on Next War India Pakistan.
Yeah, that was awesome. I've got 6 or 7 more videos coming. I'm just going to dribble and drab them out over the next couple of weeks. But the net of that game is that it's Frank Chadwick's Third World War with all the cool new toys. And it's freaking awesome, and it's clean and tight and plays well. Once you get the little bits and pieces down, the air war runs super fast. I don't know why everyone's bitching and moaning about that. The air war's awesome fun. And that, I probably got spoiled because I was talking to Mitch 2 nights ago, 3 nights ago, And he said, oh yeah, that loose nuke scenario is the best scenario of the three games. So now that you've got your expectations set really high, go play some of the others. So I enjoyed the hell out of that. And yeah, that's my first time I've touched it. So
we'll see. Well, eventually, hopefully, you'll get to Taiwan and Korea.
Yep, I'm not sure I'm going to do Taiwan, but I will do Korea. I think there's a couple of new scenarios he did for Korea that, well, I'm interested in the South. The South goes into North Korea. I'm interested in that scenario. And I'm interested in the revised, well, here's how, you know, the North Koreans really kind of suck, and here's where they're at, what would really happen. Those two scenarios I'm interested in, but I'm not interested in playing these what-if games that have, you know, hyper-inflated counter values for one side to make a game of it, which is, you know, Mitch has, you know, said that in writing, that he had to... He had to make the North Koreans tougher, otherwise it was over in two turns.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Well, it's funny because when I was in Korea in 1994, 1995, and of course that was when the first game came out, Crisis Korea 1995, and of course we played the hell out of that game when I was over there. Nobody was really that worried about a North Korean offensive. Now they were worried about artillery strikes on Seoul. Oh yeah, they were really worried about that. But in terms of North Korean South, the funny thing was, is among the Bubbas, and this is a long time ago now, this is like 20 years ago, they were more worried about holding the rock back from attacking the North.
You're the second person that said that.
Yeah. And that was back in 1994, 1995. We were talking about that. It's like, we're here on the peninsula.
Well, I wouldn't unleash Pandora's box these days, I don't think. So let's let them go.
Who knows? I mean, you know, there's all kinds of speculation about that. But it was funny because that very same year, Pacific Rim did a counterattack magazine with a Korea 1995 game where that was the scenario. Was the South was attacking the North, which was caused all kinds of kerfluffle. But I'm sure they had an inside or track because that's exactly what we were talking about.
Interesting.
Inside the headquarters.
Yeah. Yeah. So I've been playing that. That's been really good fun. That India-Pakistan game is a lot of fun. You get all the toys all at once: cruise missiles and Scuds and special forces and F-35s and J-30s and you name it, it's there and it blows things up. It's pretty awesome. So lots of tactical choices.
Yeah,
like lots of tactical choices in the game. You know, you've got to manage your forces well. Although you do have an excess of air, of course, but that's another story. Played some Pacific War yesterday. That was good.
Oh, now what do you think about that? It's been years.
We're playing the Guadalcanal campaign scenario. Yeah, that's what I've heard, and I'm the Japanese, and I got intercept on the first month in August, so I thwarted the initial invasion, and this month in September I'm under surprise, and it's day 12 of the time cycle, and the Marines have finally landed after fairly heavy losses. They landed with 17 and lost 5 getting on deck, but I've still got two battalions of Marines and two battalions of engineers, or two regiments I think they are, maybe battalions of the engineers, and my carriers are now I've got two carriers within strike range. We're about to go into the reaction phase, and I should be able to put a hit on the Saratoga and its buddy, whichever carrier is that might be. So I think there's a few flaws, you know, but it's fun. We're having a good time. It's really hard to do anything with air against infantry or airfields or anything like that, because it just gets, you know, you recover very easily and you repair very easily if you're in supply or in what they call in command with a command link. But the naval battles we've had so far have been epic, and the minor air skirmishes that we've had have been, well, pretty one-sided, but that's okay. It's been very, very good fun.
Well, Mark is supposed to be redoing that game. I forget which company.
He's doing it with Nuts Publishing.
Yeah, that's right. So I'll be interested to see. Nuts has never done anything that big.
Right.
So,
I think they're undercharging. I think the current pre-order price is 50 or 60 euros.
That's
and if,
crazy.
And if they're doing that whole game the way it should be, I think they're probably off by 50 points. So that could be a problem. But if they do those big, thick counters, and if Mark is actually really going to invest the effort in a revision of the rules for some clarity on just a whole range of little things, and perhaps tuning up some of the units, and you know, I've got a buddy who's a big military history buff. He's probably got nearly as many books as you. He had a pile of books by the game map yesterday when I turned up, and I went, well, this doesn't look very promising. He's reading Dunnigan and Nofi's book on the campaign and all this other stuff, and he goes, oh, I told you this cruiser should have an extra gun factor. And I'm like, like, okay, dude, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm just gonna sink it anyway. So I sent his ass packing in August. He steamed away with one ship limping, one battleship almost sunk. So I lost a light cruiser to get it, but it was worth it. It's good fun.
Well,
right.
Version, so he's really hoping that he can get that to work this time. So I guess we'll see. Of course, I'm going to buy it. I have three copies of that game. I've got one very well loved copy, and I had two in the shrink. And a long time ago, I was like, you know, I'm never going to do that. So I just sold them off for quite a nice price.
Yeah, well, you probably sold them at the right time, because you can get them now for, I saw one go cheap in an eBay, a Board Game Geek auction, and went for $20. It's selling for around $60 or $40 right now.
I sold my first one, I sold for $180.
Nice.
And my second one, I sold for $160.
Yeah, that's nice. I paid $60 for mine. Punched. Exactly. Got to optimize, right? Well, that's one of the cool things about having a blog. You know, I can play a game, everyone gets excited about it. Next thing you know, it's out of print. I was like, well, I guess you could buy this if you really want to.
Well, I'm waiting for Italian Combat Series, The Last Breaks. It's supposed to be at my doorstep on Monday. So, see if I can get a few squares back out of that.
You won't like it. Yeah, no, you're gonna love it. You'll love the command system and the supply system in this thing. You've read the rules, right?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's really, really interesting.
Actually, the most attractive to me. I was trying to get Jack Rady to do something like that in Horsemen Pocket 2. He's really strict his system down. He's like, no, this is actually even more complicated than I want to do. It's like, okay. But I said, it makes eminent sense to me.
Right. Yeah. The other thing that's interesting with that, the last Blitzkrieg game or the system is, I think, because I haven't played it yet, but choosing which type of unit you'll use to conduct combat that will generate not only the best result for you, but the least fatigue. So there's that dichotomy that you have to weigh. So are you going to burn out, you know, the Panzer Division early for big gains and then rest them? Or are you going to try and, you know, mete out the punishment along the way and then rest them later? So there's all sorts of little factors that come into play there, and tie that in with the supply system and the way the command and combat trains all work. It's pretty nifty.
Yeah, that's what I got from the rules. It looked like, now, we have not seen a game take on these aspects of the battle, so it's truly new.
Yes. Yes.
So I'm really looking forward to it.
Yeah, lots of new concepts as well. I think it's going to...
Well, that'll be good, because I haven't played my Vakam Ryan Grand Operational Series system set. This thing is so... I've never found a good monster bulge game, so I'm hopeful that this will be that.
I was talking to... Who was I talking to? Oh, so Mitch Land, the guy that did the design work for the Next War series, huge OCS fan, and,
okay,
you know, big Dean Essig fan. He thinks that... and loves RDN 44 and Simonich games. He said this is now his go-to bulge game, and thinks that anyone who likes OCS is going to jump on the bandwagon with this system. And he doesn't think, he agrees with me, he doesn't think it'll be long before someone works out how to graft the command, control, supply rules onto OCS.
Oh, now that would be awesome.
And get rid
I
of...
I think supply rules would do a lot for OCS.
Right. Yep. Yep.
Yeah, that would do a huge thing. Nothing is certain. Right.
Well, it takes away, it would allow you to take away the shuttling of trucks backwards and forwards. You get your supply, you get the, depending on what you roll, you've got these, you know, formation activations, right? And then that's how many, that'll drive what sort of, what level of activity you could have using those objective chits. What level of activity can you conduct in that area? That's where the SP will be spent. So it would work. Someone needs to test it, but it would work. And you could save yourself an hour a turn on a game the size of Case Blue. That's a lot. That, you know, Case Blue GB2, that's a lot of time.
Yeah.
It means you can play it twice more a year.
Maybe it would come to your house.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So that's it. That's all I've really been doing. I've been doing that and RDN 44 online, and I've got a Band of Brothers intermittent vassal thing going that I'm trying to get wrapped up, because I've surprisingly enjoy that game a little bit more than I thought I would.
Well, I like your videos on that game, because it really does give you a good sense of how it plays.
Right.
So I think those are really good for, especially for people deciding what kind of tactics. Because I tell people, I said, look, if I were to get people into tactical level War II ground gaming, that system is pretty powerful.
Yep.
I am torn between using that and Conflict of Heroes, just because Conflict of Heroes is so easy to get into, and it is Euro-ish.
Right.
But lock and load, especially if I think I'm going to move somebody into something like ATS or ASL, probably want to start it there. And graphically, it's so gorgeous.
Right.
It's really easy to get people into. But again, yeah, there are drawbacks. The armor systems, for some people, it's not that great. You know, you have the shake and bake syndrome, or shake and take, I'm sorry. Shake
right,
and take
right.
With shaking units in close combat and stuff. But in the end, I still think it holds up really well.
Yeah, passes the smell test. Anyway. That's what I've been up to.
Well, Marco, what have you been doing?
Did I miss the discussion of the last Blitzkrieg?
That's what he was showing us.
I missed it.
Sucks to be you.
I'll have to wait for the videos. And Eric, were you talking about Paul Blau?
Yeah. Oh yeah. Frank Blanche came with
I missed that too.
Works for ages. Oh yeah. No, this is one of those games that it's on my bucket list. I've got to play it because this is a throwback to old style Eastern Front games, but with ECS / Victory in the West / Operation Typhoon. And it's gorgeous. It's beautiful to look at. You lay all that stuff out. It's like.
Yeah, I was looking at. I was.
Very beautiful.
Yeah, it's nice. I was looking at it yesterday, but a buddy of mine bought it. I didn't order it. I think I'm going to wait till the secondhand market, because there'll be some doofus who doesn't like it. I'll pick it up then.
But, you know, who knows how balanced it is. But in terms of mechanics, I love that system. I love the subject. Case Blue, unlike Kevin, I can't lay out on my table completely, much less attach it to who Darren's Cryptic 2 and play this whole thing. So this will scratch my itch for playing a whole campaign.
Yeah, it's a lot bigger than I thought it was.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, it really is. I was surprised. It's a mini monster, I think, but I think it'll play really quickly.
Yep. Now, I assume it's going to, with Victory in the West system, it's going to have all the locking Zocs and stuff like that. So once you're in a Zoc, you're stuck until you retreat out or you kill something.
I haven't read the rules yet, but I would expect it'll be something like that.
Right.
We'll see. You know, we'll see. I would hope that would be the case.
Right.
So I just got it on Wednesday.
That's pretty cool.
But what
have you got on the? So what do you have on the table right now?
Just all I've got on the table right now is Duel for the North.
Right.
Right now. And once I wrap up, and I'm playing a historical game, so I'm not using inverted Soviet counters. And I'll do that probably when I play through one more. But I just want to see what it is with the way it is. Some of the board game geek / consum world things is, oh yeah, it's a romp for the Germans. Well, you know, that's always a challenge. When I hear that, it's like, yeah, well, let's play it. Let's find out for ourselves. That's going to redouble my efforts to play a crappy Soviet, because I never like it when people say that. So I want to mess around with that a little bit.
Hey, Eric, I didn't even catch the name of the game. What is it?
Duel for the North, it's a World of War magazine game, and it's one of the more attractive ones. The map, when you look at it, it reminds you of Barbarossa Army Group North. It's a Joe Use map. But obviously, it's not that big. One standard size map. Division scale for both sides. But it's got some unusual wrinkles and twists in the system that I find attractive. So it's chip pull. For both sides, and the other twist is you can decide once you activate your four units or army units for the Soviets, you can decide, do I want to fight first and then move, or move first and then fight? So to me, that's part of the interest. There's a few other bells and whistles with it too. There's this whole bidding war that goes on with air power, much like if you played some of the folio games with artillery. The same kind of thing. There's a lot of psychological tension with that. I'm really interested in finally playing it. But yeah, I had a couple of, well, more than a couple of rules questions. They're minor rules questions, but the rules questions were less. I finally got Eric Harvey to give me those replies. So all I'm waiting for is some determinations on some iffy looking hexes. And I'm not sure that they're playable or not. Once I get that. Well, actually, I'm not going to wait. I've already decided I'm going to play it like they're not playable. And then we'll see what happens. Because I haven't gotten feedback on that.
Is it two playable or solitaire?
It's two players. And which is unusual because, yeah, there's been mostly solitaire.
The two player?
World of War and Modern War. Two players, yeah. Yeah. But I
so
see.
Do the Soviets, huh? Do the Soviets get to choose move, fight, move?
Right.
Just like the Germans?
Yeah. Yeah. The problem with the Soviets is they aren't going to get as many activation chips. So what you do is you pick the activation chips you want to put in the cup, and then the good news is whatever you put in the cup will get played. You just don't know what order it's in.
Sounds extraordinarily ahistorical, Eric, and I'm not sure I'm a fan of it.
I won't know until I actually play it.
Breaking your immersion, isn't it, Kevin?
I think it sounds excellent. That's cool.
Yeah. What's a design for effect thing? It always is.
Yeah.
You may not like the mechanic of how you get this. It's like the Dark Valor. Same idea. Really, it is. You may not like how you get to your result, but the result itself feels right.
Right. Yeah, a lot of people had the hates on that game, Dark Valor.
I understand why, because it feels very gamey when you play it. Very gamey.
We're talking Dark Valor?
Yeah. I had a question for Devin.
Uh-oh.
So Devin, you're cycling on to 21st century Polish friends game system.
Yeah.
And one of the things I'll be curious to hear back from you is, aside, you know, lack of clarity on the rules, I felt that the game system just didn't feel terribly engaging. I didn't really, as I'm playing the game, results would occur and things would happen, and there were no markers to kind of keep track of what happened and why, and then there's no, you know, suppression marker or this marker or all.
Yeah.
It really made me feel like I was just moving some stuff around, and then some things happened, and I had to make notes on the side or turn counters or whatever it may be, and the story kind of just got lost. Like the and it seemed pretty straightforward too. Basic.
The one problem I do see with it is the lack of administration counters, especially when you're spending movement points to fire, and then the opponent fires back, spending his movement points. It's going to be interesting. Like I said, all I got right now is just theorycraft and reading rules. Until I actually get into the nuts and bolts of it, I'm not going to be. I'm not sure how it's theorycraft. When I get through it, when I can play with it, then I can give a better feedback to Achish to say, hey, because for some reason this game is just huge over in Poland. It's one of his biggest sellers. I mean, Christoph, you know who Christoph is. He loves it. Martin,
yeah.
Another one of the guys from Poland, he just absolutely loves it. For some reason, this game is actually huge among the people who play Tactics.
I want to like it. I tried to like it. You know, I want it to be good, and that's why I bought those Maripol scenarios. Because who else is doing anything on the Ukraine right now?
Nobody.
Right.
So yeah, I mean, I want to like it too, because there are no decent. Well, aside from lack of a World War, there is no decent tactical or strategic modern day aside.
Well, I got some scoop. I got some scoop for you, dude. Here's some scoop. I was talking to Mitch Land about the next war, Poland, that's coming out. And I'm going to butcher the name, but Eric will know the location because Eric knows Lithuania, Estonia pretty well. But there's a portion of Poland that just kind of juts into Lithuania.
It's called the Polish Corridor. It's like 19 miles.
Yeah, and there's a town there called Zilziki or Zilziki or something like that. That's where the Poland War thing is going to be set, the next war scenario. And he was talking to some guy who's a general or was a general or pretended to be a general or had general's bars once. And they told him that that's the spot, right, for that whole area. And he's going to have these strategic maps attached to the Poland map that will allow you to move units in and out of other areas in that kind of that corridor, even including the Ukraine. Because originally he looked at the Ukraine area and could only come up with 15 battalions that were combat capable in that whole region. So he said, well, there's no game there. That's why we're going to be doing the Poland thing, which I think is going to be pretty freaking cool.
And the assumption is that the Belarus is going to allow Russian forces to transit, because it's that corridor is sandwiched between Belarus and Russian Kaliningrad, which is this little enclave in the former Konigsberg area. But if NATO intends to defend the Baltics, they have to have that land LOC from Poland through that narrow neck corridor into the Baltics. And if you've read anything in the paper, whether it's by Rand or anybody else, everybody says you can't defend it, not without forward position forces there. You know, the Russians will beat us to the punch and cut it off, and that's it. So it'll be interesting to see what he does with this, in terms of what can the Poles do? Can they hold on long enough for NATO to get there in time? Yeah, right. Good luck with that. But anyway, we'll see. The Germans will be really upset if their train timetables are interrupted by the movement of military forces across Germany into Poland. Now, Poland ain't worth sacrificing my morning commute. I'm sorry.
Was ist das? Yeah, it's going to be interesting. Well, he does do those scenarios where you have these build-up. He's got different levels of build-up, so I'm sure they'll all play out differently.
Yeah, that'll be good. Yeah, and if anybody thinks, now the Marines think, oh, this is great. We'll just get a Marine Expeditionary Force into Riga or Tallinn, and that'll be great. We'll just supply it via sea. And I'm thinking, can you say speedboat?
Yeah, really. Yeah, that's not even gonna.
I love my Marine brothers to death, but sometimes they have an overly inflated sense of what they can actually do in the face of a full Soviet onslaught.
Yeah.
All I will say is they will die well.
Well,
they will take many with them, but they will die well.
It'll come down to the air war, right?
Well, air and logistics.
Yeah.
And personally, here's my particular take, which I've run Baltic scenarios for the college, unclassified, and the best Russian strategy in our scenarios has been, okay, if we're going to pressure the Baltics, we're going to do it during the onset of winter, kind of like November, because it gets really cold then. And who's supplying all their petroleum?
Russia.
That would be us. So we basically threaten to cut it off, and if we cut it off, they're going to be dependent on the West. And it's like, okay, you're going to have to transit all that through the Baltics. Well, who owns the Baltics? And if we take Gotland, Sweden, what do you think? Because the Swedish they don't have any forces really to defend it. And you're smack dab in the middle of the transits that you'd need. And even if you didn't take Gotland, could I possibly cause insurance rates for commercial shipping to go through the route? I think I could. Little green men on boats. I think we could. I think piracy, I think terrorism, I think all that would do that. And if insurance rate... So, you Estonians, you Lithuanians, you Latvians, how much you paid for fuel during the winter? A little more than you can afford. Well, you know what? We could give you such a great deal. And of course, all of this military deployment goes into the Baltics. And these are GIs and Germans and Italians, especially Italians, flush with money in their pockets, and you know what that's going to do to the local economy? Inflation. Okay? And the Russian mob is going to do a marvelous thing by saying, we can get in here, jack up contracts, corruption in contracts, because there's sizable Russian minorities in there, and oh, by the way, we are going to bring the girls. Right? We're going to bring the girls. And so the girls are espionage network. Girls are going to be able to do all kinds of things, because that's what the mob does in the Baltics, is run prostitution. So it's like, oh, and we won't even talk about cyber attack.
Yeah.
And the military, it'll be against energy infrastructure, data networks like pipelines and everything else. I mean, if you're the president of Estonia, Lithuania, Latvia, the military of NATO is bringing you more problems than they're solving. And it's primarily an economic issue for you at this point, especially in the winter when everybody's screaming for cheap. So that's something that never makes it into people's brains.
Interesting. Very interesting.
Well, I can't wait for one small steps game, Putin Strikes. I can't wait.
It'd be interesting to see how that actually comes together, right? Don't you go teaching people how to do stuff, Eric, otherwise you'll have people upset with you.
Well, they already are, but that's okay. There's something about being in a satellite campus far from Kansas. As the Prussians like to say, there's nothing so glorious as being on detachment. Okay? You know, we are far from the flagpole, life is good. So my whole thrust is getting the students to question authority in a tactful way instead of jumping on the bandwagon, running like lemmings off the side of the cliff. So I want them to basically have enough critical thinking they can say, why are we? You know, explain it to me like I'm a 6-year-old, because I'm not getting it. So that, for me at least, has been going really well.
As much as I applaud you for doing that, the problem I see with this is that higher command can sit back and say, well, just get on the bandwagon of the way we do things, or it'll appear in your fit rep.
Oh, yeah. There is no
critical thinking left in lower ranks anymore. That went out the window in Vietnam.
Well, it can be done, but yes, you have to be willing to potentially pay that price.
There's no price.
And we teach a lot in ethics and everything else about, you know, those professional dilemmas. And all of us who've have done this at relatively senior levels have had those ethical dilemmas. Some of us have paid for it. Some of us have been lucky and gotten away with it. And you never know what you're really, really going to get. But as Colonel John Boyd used to say, really, you have two options. You can either be somebody important, or you can do something important. It's very rare you get to do both. So you're going to get a choice. You're going to be somebody but not really do anything important, or you're going to do something important, and that means you're going to have to forego being somebody important. And so, yeah, we talk about that. We talk about the leadership. We talk about that, the ethics. But I give them a lot of casework from Vietnam to Iraq to Afghanistan that shows what happened when you get on the bandwagon. And so, especially with regards to Iraq and Afghanistan, the Iraq surge and Obama's Afghan surge, we show the downside of marching to the military drum that the chairman of Chief of Staff is beating. So it really discomfits them when they figure out that President Bush ignored all the military advice he was getting. I mean, all of it. From the chairman all the way down to do the Iraq surge. He listened to a bunch of outsiders. And a lot of people go, you know, I ask the question, so who's right? Should you have listened to the guys on the inside? Or should you listen to the guys on the outside? You know? And what do you do if you're in uniform? Whose side are you on?
So what should have the strategy been?
Yeah, this is very uncomfortable.
Right.
But, you know, I said, look, you know, if you go and read the Pentagon Papers from the Vietnam War, here's what happens. Everybody starts singing the same song in the name of loyalty and being with the captain of the football team. That's okay, and yeah, that's what the military preaches. But unfortunately, good advice is not often rendered to the President of the United States. And we've seen this time and time and time again. Somebody's got to be the outsider. And And yeah, they may pay for it professionally, but somebody's got to.
The problem is, and I know we're getting a little bit off the wargaming subject, I don't see if a major conflict erupts, and I'm not talking this, guerrilla action, that we've got over in Afghanistan, Iraq, those are not major national combats. I'm talking China, I'm talking Russia. We get into an actual shooting war with that, we're not going to do real well, because too many of the officer corps, and no offense to the officer corps that you were as a Marine, but too many of them listen to the political advice of what they're supposed to do according to regulations and not what is going to work on the battlefield.
Right. No, that's for true.
This is a leadership style that I've seen in effect since Vietnam.
Right.
I mean, I don't want to say we got lucky in the Gulf War. We didn't, but we really weren't fighting a high-quality enemy at the time.
Right. Right.
So
everybody... I would say that the best example to read in history is the Austro-Hungarian Army from about 1866 to 1918. I think if you read that, you've got a good sense of what we're facing. And somewhere it's got to stop. I mean, I go back to the old army, for example. People who were muckrakers, people who were against, the Joseph, Vinegar Joe Stilwells, the Hunter Liggetts. These were the Billy Mitchells. These were the guys who questioned authority, and like Billy Mitchell, sometimes paid for it. Where did those guys go? Where did they go? We don't have them anymore. What changed that made that happen, and why can't we go back to that earlier time? And I think that's those are important things for people to come to grips with.
As being former enlisted, and that's where my focus has always been, my concern, and you know this just as well, if we do get into a major shooting war, the leadership practices of modern military officer corps are going to get a lot of my brothers and sisters.
Yeah. Well, what did they say?
I'll be off in a little bit.
10,000 lives to train a good major general?
Just give me 10 more minutes.
Okay. World War II, Tom Ricks writes about this. Marshall ended up firing a lot of generals. When was the last time we had a general fired for incompetence? To my mind, there's only been two. Both Marines, both two stars. General Gerganis and General Sturtevant during the Bastion attack that shot up six carriers and a squadron commander and an aircraft in that kill. Those were the only two we've done, really, since World War II. For professional incompetence. So what we need is a command game, command and control optional rules, like we get in Shetler's Winter Storm situation, and get them put in modern game. That you can challenge the high command.
Right.
Lose, get fired, cashiered, censured, and all that kind of stuff.
You don't even need to make it an optional game. You can make an entire game out of that alone.
Yeah.
Who's got
whoa.
Who's got a copy of those rules?
Am I coming in?
Yeah, I can hear you. We can hear you.
Hey, Eric. You said your Gerganis was relieved. Why?
Because here's what happens. Greg Sturtevant, who was the wing commander, okay, and Gerganis was the overall Marine commander. He was RC Southwest, okay. When the pullback in Afghanistan was happening, what they did was they got lesser NATO members to do security on the berm. And both Gerganis and Sturtevant complained to ISAF. Said, we think this is a problem. We think we're going to increase our vulnerability, lessen our force protection staff. ISAF told them, shut up and call it. They saluted smartly and complained. And when the attack came in, that shot up six.
I've got it on mute. What's that?
Last check for hours.
And got inside.
And
the
how
bomb,
many were there? Please check.
And shot up
can
six
we do
carriers.
Can you just write it down for me? What it is right now? all your different systems, just write it down on a piece of paper, and then
it's 10:50.
I don't want to know right now. I'm in the middle of having a conversation. Oh, you better believe it. Love it.
Officers, you all have signed letters of recognition the minute you became a brigadier, and they are on file in my office. Okay? You should feel liberated by what I'm doing, because now you know you're already fired. It's just a question of when it takes effect. So you should never be content. If somebody's doing that to you, you see problems, they refuse to solve it, maybe you should resign. Maybe you should resign and tell people why you're resigning. And that might get things solved. But this is because we lost 249 Marines in Beirut. Because the commander knew better, thought it was screwed up, and still went with orders from the superior. So we've now made the same mistake twice, and coming up deciding what I'm doing.
Did you guys use Rick's book in your curriculum there?
The journalist's interpretation. And while I like his sentiments, I don't think his scholarship is tight.
Yeah, I totally agree. I would have raised my eyebrow if you were using that. Hey, do you guys use Sassman case study?
I wish we did. There's a lot more case studies we should use. The case studies we use are primarily civilian business and government. So Bill Bratton, police commissioner, LA and New York and stuff, we do that. But we use very, very few military examples, honestly. Because the students come with too much emotional and whatever baggage on military examples. So we give them civilian ones where they're more likely to unbiased.
Interesting. I have a
question. But Al Hart used to say, the only thing harder than getting an idea out of the military mind, or getting a new idea in the military mind, is to get the old one out. And we find that every day.
I have a question. Who, which titles again had the command rules in the Wind of Storm series?
It's the last ones, the last three, which would be Prelude for Disaster.
Okay.
The Last Victory and Edelweiss.
Okay, cool. I'm just looking through. I've got a whole bunch of game scans here. I'm just looking to see if I've got the rules to see if I can read them.
Oh my gosh. You look lost in thought, Mark. What are you thinking?
No, I'm just, I'm reluctant to say anything because I've missed half the discussion. I don't want to sound stupid saying something that you guys have already gone over. So,
yeah.
Okay. There's a huge delay, too, for me, so. I'm happy. But we do,
Marco, you don't sound any stupider than usual. It's okay.
And look at me. I run that risk every time I open my mouth.
Well, we do. We use Lieutenant Colonel Sassman's case study at NPS, and it did cause some pretty heated discussions between guys. I mean, I was in the first ID right after. Fourth ID had Sassman, and the guy said, sitting right next to me was in fourth ID under Sassman. So, yeah. So it's a very divisive case in terms of you know, what people what become. The official investigation cleared him of all that, but you know, still people think, well, it's a kinetic climate. He was a very kinetic guy. When he went out to NTC for the MRX, he completely disregarded all the OC comments about, you know, doing all this kind of stuff. It was all about kinetic ops. But actually, when he was there, he was doing the usual thing, Shiraz, the usual two-year engagements. But yeah, he had a more kinetic bet. But he never told anybody, a la, you know, Jack Nicholson, you know, did you order a Cobra? Your dad, but I did. No, none of that.
I have another question. Who is enjoying the new format of the BGG pages?
Yeah, the game pages aren't quite as nice.
Yeah, I'm right now. I'm looking to try and work out how to follow a game, and I can't find it anymore. But anyway.
Yeah, I think, well, I don't think it's easy to see everything on it either, like the old pages.
Right. Devin, it's all about white space, and if you don't want to accept those design criteria, then you should just not participate.
That's racist, saying it's all white.
Hey, white space matters too.
That's right. We can't have these cluttered web pages. That's the problem. They're cluttered. We've got to economize. We need to be graphically pleasing.
I just can't figure out how to find anything on the new pages anymore. I just don't like the look of them. I don't like the layout. I don't like how they've done the browse photos. I don't like where they have the forms and the files and everything. Something needs to be done, but what they did was not it.
Hmm. Well,
of course, I say the same thing about Consent World and TMP, but they're never going to change their form.
Yeah, Consent World's awful.
That's it. Change is its own reward.
Sometimes.
Hey, sometime. Sometime we should have a conversation and glean information from Eric's massive brain of military history, and talk about the most successful empires over the history of humanity. I would be interested in having a conversation about that sometime. I'm writing an article about the Mongols now. It's
okay.
More of a plagiarism than an article that I've written, but it's beside the point.
Depends on how you define success.
I have three or four criteria. So, you know, total mass, land mass, number of battles won, and economic value of that, you know, those assets, and then the fourth is the fighting capability. Dupuy,
yeah.
Who has that scale that lets you
compare,
he compares 10,000 savages to a panzer division.
That's the quantified judgment model.
Right. So, you know, I kind of put that to one side because I'm only dealing with either, you know, pre-modern and modern in terms of empire assessment, but I have some some minor thoughts on it, and I'd be curious about having a conversation with you guys about the Western preconceived notions of, you know, Alexander, Napoleon, the Roman empires versus the Persian, Assyrian, Mongol efforts, and then you know, in modern times, which empires were great as well.
Yeah, to me, it's all about longevity and impact after the fall. How many vestiges of your empire still remain in terms of what have you done for social awareness, legal systems, financial systems, you know, that kind of thing. So for me, off the top of my head, and I haven't really thought of it, I would say the Byzantine Empire was the most successful. That would be one. Because Alexander, Napoleon, they were flashes in the pan.
Right.
The Mongols, actually, were flashes in the pan.
Yes.
Speaking, even though they had a couple hundred years, what's left of them?
Nothing. Okay, good stuff.
Of course, there's the British Empire, the American Empire.
This sun never sets on it, my dear boy.
Right. Why? It's funny because I was doing a staff ride in Yorktown and I was trying to convince my students about, you know, in 1781, American bias notwithstanding, because, of course, all these historians, they only talk about North America. And I said, do you understand that we were a backwater for the British Empire at that particular time? There were far more important things. Did you realize that the island of Jamaica produced more value in terms of pounds sterling per annum than the entire 13 colonies combined? And the Caribbean was twice that of the 13 colonies, and India, depending on who you read, was between 5 and 7 times the value? And you had the second Mysore War, 1780, first Palm War, the British get humiliated at the hands of Hyder Ali and his son Tipu Sultan. You know, the East India Company is on the ropes, and the French are trying to make their way back, Pondicherry. You know, oh, and the Spanish want Gibraltar, and they're tearing the ass across Texas and Mobile, and eventually they're going to take Pensacola. Do you understand that what's going on in North America is way, way, way low of the totem pole? And both Cornwallis and Clinton understand that.
Right. It's not even a rounding error.
No. And so if you understand the global situation, understanding why Clinton was doing what he was doing, why Cornwallis was doing what he was doing, makes perfect sense. But you have to see it in a global perspective. And I can't find a lot of Americans.
America.
Yeah, America.
America.
That right there is the reason. America plus the shoddy school system not being able to just refresh.
Well, you know, but even if you have you know, my guys go to a private Christian school, right? So we a little more steeped in ancient history and all the rest of it, but even so, the Western centric viewpoint and the American centric viewpoint really comes across in the history. And I get into it with my oldest sometimes on various topics that they spend time on. And it's like, well, yes, but here's what else was happening at that time. Why don't you bring that up with your teacher just out of interest to see what they have to say? He does it sometimes and then comes back and goes, oh, Dad, you're wrong. Yeah, that's right. You're 16. I don't count anymore. I forgot.
16-year-olds know everything.
Yeah. He's a smart young lad, and he knows I know my stuff, and he won't. Well, when I say I know my stuff, I mean I know a little bit, right, relative to him. But
yeah, that's the only good advantage. You know more than he does.
Right, right. So he now we don't engage on projects. So I'll seize at some paper that he gets back, and he's got some grass. Hey, good job on that. What's this? And he goes, oh, nothing. It's just a paper on the Roman Empire. It's no big deal. Would you talk to me? I would love to help you with that. Let me see that. Oh, no, this guy didn't do that. No, he was a good guy, not a bad guy. What are you talking about? Yeah, interesting. Yeah.
Well, to me, especially in history courses, it's less that you have answers, you have more questions. And I think if you do that, and they're good questions, they're entering questions, I think that's the best value.
Right.
But often we have two pat answers, especially in American history, the way I see it.
Right.
Or it's too leftist and out of the box, in which case that's almost as bad. Because it's like, you're not seeing the good things that happen. You know?
Yeah.
There were some good things that happened. So, yes, we massacred a lot of Indians, put the reservations on the West. We never would have been a global empire if we hadn't.
Yes, you would not have your iPod in your freaking electric car if that didn't happen.
Right. So I like the
sure, there's no absolutism in historical discussions, which is one of the things that kind of annoys me about even with my son's education, is that there's some absolutes there, because there's this biblical reference to everything, because of sort of contextual implications, and that's fine, but that doesn't mean, let's accept that that's law, right? But that doesn't mean that whatever the teacher says about anything is law. That just means that it's up for grabs. You don't want to argue about the biblical import and all that sort of stuff. Got it. But let's talk about the history with the Romans or the Greeks or the Depression era in America and all that sort of stuff. There's a lot more to it.
Yes. Oh, there is. But, we don't tend to do that. It's like, I use the analogy, it's like we teach the Niels Bohr atom. Everyone knows that's been a lie since 1936. We don't want to talk about quantum physics. That's too hard. Okay, so I felt lied to when I got to college level, physics and chemistry, and they said, oh no, the stuff you learned in high school, that's not how it works. It's like, how long have we known that? Oh, 1936. It's like, really? We've known that long? Oh yeah. But it solves high school chemistry.
See, I was unaware of that. I didn't know that. That's interesting.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you remember that. It's like, okay, I'm going to move these electrons from ring to ring to ring. I'm going to show you how covalent bonding happens between two elements, moving electronics around, and this is how molecules form and all that. It's a lie. Absolute lie. Oh, yeah, but we still teach it. Why do you do that?
Wow.
If I talked about electrons popping, this location to this location at zero time, that's so counterintuitive. They'll never get that.
We need to give kids more credit.
True, right? Or at least we think it's true right now.
Right. Right.
We talk about electron clouds because we can't do rings because it's probabilities of where electrons are likely to pop up by where they are. Because Heisenberg's principle, you can do either velocity or position. You can't do both. Yeah, we don't want to inflict that on our high school.
So we create artificial constructs to explain the how systems work. Interesting.
Yes, ancient artificial constructs, earliest 20th century artificial
constructs. Good. Well, I'll use that with my son. That's all bullshit, kid.
They won't solve high school chemistry problems. All right. Okay.
Right, teach them something else then, right? Maybe they don't need to know how to do high school chemistry problems, right?
Or just admit, we can't teach a covalent bond because it takes a level of mathematical and physics and chemistry knowledge that you don't have and you're not going to get. That's later. I'm just going to say it's magic, okay? just magic. Okay, you'll learn about how to do it later, but right now it's magic.
Right, right. Yes, sir. It's just like all the miracles with the Bible. It's magic, and we're going to put it to one side, and we're going to move on. That's how my school probably should handle it, right?
It's just magic.
Yep. Yep. Jazz hands, right? Oh, that's great. That's great. Well, I probably should go and be nice to my wife and help my kids be prepared for Mother's Day tomorrow.
And I should probably get dinner started.
All right. Well, I lost Marco for good, so.
Yeah, poor guy. It's not fun. He's having technology issues.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. I'll blame his system administrator.
Yeah, which is him, right?
I didn't say that.
Didn't name any names.
So, anyway, what's great talking to you all as always.
Yep.
As always.
Peace.